since he is a greater villain than I.
Ah, yes. A foolish girl to try and pick the pocket of Sweeney Todd. Yes, I am Sweeney Todd, the finest barber in London. This is my establishment. Note the inscription. It's in Latin, you know. I am also a great scholar, and freely translated it reads, today, gone tomorrow. My little joke, you know. My little joke, you know. But I have no time to waste talking. It is time my shop was opened. But you shall see, all of you, that my razor is as sharp as my wit.
I do not need such a thing as an apprentice.
Now I have him. That is just a taste, boy, of what you will get if you do not do as you are told. Go sign the papers. From now on, you will not breathe without my permission. Do you understand me?
Yes, Mr. Todd.
Yes, Mr. Todd. Sir.
Yes, Mr. Todd. Sir.
Now get inside and get to work.
And I'm only little.
And I suppose you feel sorry for the wretch. Oh, yes, you do. Do you think kindness is any use? Would I be where I am today if I had been kind? No, evil is the way. I do enjoy it so. But look at the time, and still no customers. Aha, now this looks like a likely customer. Well dressed, wealthy perhaps, and a stranger to these parts. I always reserve a warm welcome for strangers. I will prepare something special for him.
Well, well, oh confound the girl, fool! Oh, well, oh, how the mighty are fallen, that I, the great Alonso, illusionist extraordinaire, who have journeyed through the lands of the Arabian Nights and captured all the necromantic arts of the Mystic East, should sink so low as to be played with an imbecile such as this.
Don't you speak in that way.
Look, girl, look in your hand. What do you see?
Nothing, sir. No, I tell a lie. It's...
The other hand, simpleton. Vacuous villain, where is Orlando?
Don't worry, sir, they'll be close by. I expect you found not a bit of exercise. A lady dog, perhaps. You know what I mean, sir? An outpost, perhaps. I'll go and find him, sir, and I'll take a seat.
It is unnecessary, Twile. He approaches. Fortunately, he is more intelligent than his keeper.
Here, Orlando. Here,
Orlando. Ah, Orlando. You bring back golden memories. To think that you and I have enchanted the crowned heads of Europe with our sorcery. Archdukes and kings have begged me to reveal my secrets. An audience. If only there were an audience, I would show you the wonders, Poel.
Well, actually, sir...
Miracles I could perform. But without an audience, what purpose would there be?
But look, sir...
Should I waste my incantations upon the empty air? A conjure without an audience is like...
Look, sir, an audience.
Foolish child, that is not an audience. It is a rabble.
I wouldn't say that, sir.
Of course not. You're even more ridiculous than they are. But Orlando knows I have performed before much greater audiences than this. But no, no, you must not beg me to perform an illusion. You must not beg me to perform an illusion. Very well, if you insist. Let me see. What species of illusion would appeal to an audience such as this? You're right, of course, my faithful hound. My most elementary trick will please their simple minds. Well, the receptacle. The hat. And for this illusion, I will need the assistance of a member of the audience. You, madam, perhaps. Yes, you, madam. The one with the vacant expression. Step up here, please. Inspector. Hold the receptacle, madam. Well, the ingredients. Inspect the receptacle. No hidden compartments?
No.
Then observe. I'm about to test your courage and determination. I have here... a gold sovereign. It could be yours, madam. All you have to do is take, and without opening your eyes, put on the hat. A gold sovereign, madam. It could be yours. Close your eyes and take the hat. Voila! A big hand for the lady. Thank you very much. Outside the gym palace, Smithfield, 6 o'clock. Alas, I have fallen. victim to the demon drink. Oh, misery. I say, hello there, fellow, barber.
Who knows what might have become of him if I had not taken him in?
Who is
fact of my delicious pie should be nearly ready. Speaking of the shop, Mr. Todd, I find myself a little short of pie filling, Mr. Todd.
Then why do you not speak to the butcher, Mrs. Lovett?
The barbarous villain plays games with me. No butcher can supply me with the meat of the quality my customers have come to expect.
Your customers? Ah, yes, indeed, I see a bigger throng about your door each day. Your business is expanding. And to think I can remember the days when you were starting out in the pie-making business. You were finding it very difficult to make both ends meet. I will make her sweat.
He tries my patience. You know my meaning.
Now understand my meaning. I have a fresh supply of meat. Not yet slaughtered, but there has been a slight increase in my prices. Inflation, you know.
How much?
Double.
You, we have an agreement!
We never meet, but like gunpowder and fire, there is an explosion.
I've been a fool to fall in with your murderous schemes, Mr. Todd. Yet what can I do without your meat? My pie shop will be ruined. My customers are mad for mine. The old pies. They worship my gravy. If only they knew what they were eating. I have no alternative, Mr. Todd. I will have to pay your price.
But there is money in this for both of us. My friend,
she's no friend of mine.
If my share is greater than yours, it's because my part of the work is more hazardous.
Oh, spare me your fatuous explanations, Mr. Todd. Force me against my will to perform all manner of evils.
Pause, you come now. Do not feel the slightest satisfaction in your work.
What an idea!
Is there not a tingle of pleasure that comes with each evil deed you perform? Yes.
Yes, I do enjoy it. Why should I pretend otherwise? Sometimes I look at myself in a mirror and I say. No, I say, Mrs. Wilhemina Lovett, however did you become so magnificently wicked?
I have been roused from my hammock in a cold, black middle rock. I have walked the deck, the spray hitting in my face. But Susan was at my side and I did not feel it. I have been reaping the yards when I targeted a hand of my next mercenary. But Susan's eyes were on me, and there was light. When language cried for the masthead, I seized the glass. I could see the cliffs of England. My shipmates leapt upon the dock. They find hands to grasp and lips to press. I cry not to you. But as the dawn kisses the fields of Kent, I shall kiss the lips of the fairest flower in England. My sweet.
Oh, sorry. Wasn't this then?
I have been in sea 3 years now.
Come to the gym,
I'll join you shortly. First, I must buy for my dearest Susan the gift that I promised her on my return.
A gift?
Yes, I promised to place round her exquisite throat a string of pearls to match the beauty of her fair skin.
A string of pearls?
Yes, a string of pearls. Sometimes I'm wondering if talking to you or the parrot. Look, I've copied these lines from a book of poetry. The hours I spent with thee, dear heart, are like a string of pearls to me. I count them, every one apart, my rosary.
Ah, oh, sailors, how I would love to join in the Navy. I sent here from Italy, though I see from the inside of a lifeboat. But now I wish to see the beauties of the world. Bellissima, top of signorina in every port.
You're right, lad. A good uniform works its way with the women. Let me show you.
Breadth of Europe. Nay, the world have I ever had the misfortune.
mental incompetence such that to stop your mouth, sir, and I shall stop it permanently. But there is no time to waste. I must dispose of the evidence. The lever. Wrong lever. Now to see what this ill-tempered conjurer is worth.
This is curious. What's the purpose of this trapdoor?
What are you doing, boy?
Nothing, Mr. Todd.
Why? You're kneeling on the floor.
Are you a trip, Mr. Todd?
Tripped? Does he suspect? Be warned, my inquisitive young friend. It would be most unwise, most unwise to repeat a word which passes in this shop, or to draw any conclusion from anything you see or hear, or fancy you see or hear. Do you understand, eh?
Yes, Mr. Todd. Oh, I'd say nothing, Mr. Todd. If I as much as say one word, Mr. Todd, I wish you might be made into vampires at Mrs. Lovett's next door, Mr. Todd.
How dare you mention meat pies in my presence? I see the boy shall have to be polished off. Tobias, don't just stand there. Catch hold of the animal. Now take him to the river and throw him in. With a stone tied around his neck.
But, sir.
Do as I say.
Yes, sir.
Cursed dog. And the magician, for all his fine words, has precious little of any value on his person. Perhaps his clothing will fetch a price. Ah, this cloak is of fine quality. And this shirt is of good material, too. But what is this? Damnation! Blood here and there. I dare not let these be seen. They are fit only for the furnace. No money, worthless clothes. This magician has played his last trick, even in death. Yet his body, I'm sure, shall be of use to my grisly pie-making neighbour. We should meet no problems with that sale. But Sweeney, you must learn from your mistake. Trust the chair, aye, the chair. Why, slit throats and spilled blood, and a long fall and a broken neck will do the job. With less sanctification. Good morning, sir. Can I help you?
Good morrow, friend. I'm in need of your craft. Let my hair be cut at once, for tomorrow I have to meet a lady.
Oh, you have come to the right establishment, sir. Please sit down. You are not from London yourself, sir?
No, I returned to the village of my birth tonight.
You have been at sea, sir.
Indeed. I have just come up the river from an Indian voyage.
A great distance. I can scarcely believe my eyes. But could that be a string of pearls that hangs from this sailor's pocket? Excuse me, sir. But could that be a string of pearls that hangs from your pocket?
What? Oh, yes, indeed. I must be more careful. Let me in confidence tell you, they are worth the value of £12,000.
Yes, sir. There are some wicked people in this city, sir. You would hardly believe how wicked puts it back. Make yourself comfortable, close your eyes. It will all be over before you know what has happened. shilling soon became a pound, the pound a hundred, soon to a thousand, till I said to myself, I shall possess 100,000. This string of pearls, this shall complete my song.
Thank you.
that cursed boy, Tobias, has disobeyed me once too often.
I will not stay where I'm not welcome. This behaviour is most suspicious.
I noticed that you were speaking to Mr. Sweeney Todd.
Yeah, indeed. You know, it's no cure.
I'm just out of time to have better humour in the company of your flaming companion here. This gentleman here, he robs me of their brains, their digestion and their conscience, to say nothing of their money. Speaking of which, Mr. Todd, as I told you earlier, I'm in urgent need of 40 quid.
Oh yes, some £40.
If I ply him with drink, I may be able to get it out of him. Allow me to fill your glass, Mr. Todd.
You would believe it, madam. My situation is almost identical. My ship.
Take
My first step must be to remove the blabbing mouth of Tobias Stoutheart. Mrs. Lovett, too, grew scrupulous and dissatisfied. I have had my eye on her for a while, and I fear she intends mischief. A little poison, skillfully administered, should remove any unpleasantness in that quarter. Who's there?
Sweeney Todd, where is my master?
How should I know, imbecile?
Sweeney Todd, where is my shipping?
Why do you ask me, you nautical nitwit? Ah! Get over here! Get away from here, you bleeding mutt! Get away! Why do you help me in this way? How dare you dog my footsteps?
I'm not in salt water.
indeed. I am every inch a sailor.
They fear to arouse my anger. They know that within these walls I control all. No! Supreme power is mine! Mine! No! I am like a god. Indeed, to these poor, miserable creatures, I am a god. A god almighty. No! No!
Last anything like as long. I think they should sir, disease. Therefore, I must leave you, as a professional, to deal with the case as it seems fit.
But time presses on, Mr. Todd, and I'm sure that patients will be properly attended to.
How do you feel now? Do you still think I shall hang? Or shall you die in the padded cell of a madhouse? You see, my friends, how evil will always conquer over weak, wishy-washy goodness and kindness.
I don't know who you are, sir, but let me beg you to have the house of Sweeney Todd in Fleet Street searched, and you will find that he is a murderer.
Oh, uncommonly mad!
time to dispose of this grisly pie maker.
May God forgive me for my sins.
Well, final murder, and I should be safe.
Come, come, we have been friends these many years. Let us not quarrel now.
It is as you say, Mr. Todd. Friends, Mr. Todd, the greatest of friends.
As thieves, Mrs. Lovett.
Oh, yes, Mr. Todd. Thick, Mr. Todd. Certainly thick. Stand back and I will be shot! Sweeney Todd, I arrest you in the name of mercy!
I knew it would come to this. And all through gold, accursed gold, which men would sell their souls and barter their eternal salvation. Repent, repent, truly I repent. Will not one of you speak one word for me? Just one.
Extra, extra. Queen comes, Sweeney Todd.
What?
Queen comes, Sweeney Todd.
Well, she can't do that.
We can do whatever we like, you revolting common person. We are the queen, and here is our proclamation. It is our wish that Mr. Sweeney Todd, having been found guilty of 27 separate murders, shall not be hanged. He shall be imprisoned for
life. I'm spared! Spared! Thank the Lord!
Thank whom?
Thank you, Your Majesty.
That's better. He shall be imprisoned for life in the madhouse of Mr. Napoleon Bedlam.
No! Hang me! Hang me!
Be quiet, you ungrateful little man. Mr. Bedlam has brought, under guard, of course, some of his inmates to welcome you to their number.
Oh, no.
No, anything but this!
One, two, three, four.
Wait a minute, I'm not mad. Ask them, they'll tell you I'm not mad. Tell them, tell them.
Oh, yes you are.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Oh, yes you are.
Okay, okay, don't start enjoying yourself now, we're nearly finished.
Now, I must return to Kent to marry my sweetheart, Susan.
Alas, now what will become of me? I have no master and no money. And alas, my name isn't Susan.
Why? You're...
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Why, you're beautiful. Come to my farm and marry me, my darling.
Oh, yes, my darling. Come on, Angelo, our master is dead.
Oh, that we have secrets. His skills will live on in me. Our tutors down the crown bits of Europe. Your Majesty, pick a card.
aka Sweeney Todd.
Let's see what they've taught me.
One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four.
A two, a one, two, three, four.
Look around, see our plight, locked in here at our
thank our parents for the time and trouble and for the taxi service they provided, then taking us back, I suppose, for the rehearsals. The caretaking staff have been a great help. The clean-up after this, after you've all gone, they'll be pushing the chairs away. The office staff, they've typed all the programmes and done all the accounts for us. Our teaching staff, who have let us out with lessons, thank you. Our set this year was built by Mr. Mitchell and Mr. Baldwin. Mr. McFadden painted it. Mr. Carrot lighted it up with the assistance of Richard and Bent. Mrs. McKnight and Mrs. Booth did the costuming. Mrs. Bracegirdle did our makeup. Right, now these are the big thank yous. So we have a round of applause for Mrs. Smith.
But basically, without them, Mr. Spink and I and Mr. Smith couldn't have done anything.